swing that right swing over that.
So unfortunately I've developed a reputation as the oak that moans about dirty beer glasses. So I'm going to talk a little bit about it. But since I gave the topic to LB, a lot of time has gone past. So I think I'm going to just add a little bit extra so you guys can understand what is behind the reason. So first of all, you see a lot of this kind of stuff that comes around.
It looks delicious.
Yeah. So the previous lacing from the previous glass, you know, still on there.
That shows you how good the lacing is.
I prefer not to have that blood vessel lacing on. So, as you can see, there's many examples, and you probably see this in many restaurants. And the big thing that also gets me annoyed is that you go to beer specialist places that should know better, and you have exactly the same problem there. So everyone is like, we've worked so hard to make this beer, but then they serve it to you in a dirty glass. You know, so on social media, I want to freaking do my nutting when I see stuff like that.
Especially when it's your beer.
Now that you say that. Now that you say that.
Oh, come on, Danny.
So let's talk about why do I have this twitch, and the main reason is it's not me, it's these buggers serving us here in glasses like this. I think there's also 20 years of conditioning around, in my corporate job, and it seems to be a theme going around. One of the things that was of utmost importance, something that you got the bonus on, was around quality KPIs that you got. Foam performance, flavor stability, those kind of things. So like Danny sitting there, you were in the engineering team, and I'm pretty sure foam was on one of your KPIs as well. All right, so even the engineering guys had this as a KPI. So foam and foam performance, because of what it does for the customer, you know, it was a critical quality index, which is customer facing. And I think, so whenever I see, and I know how much work was done and how many bloody audits have been done, and you get audited, you get lambasted, you get, you know, your money taken away, those kind of things. So when I see it in the glass, I'm just like, oaks, you know, people have done so much work to get the beer where it is now. And then somebody just goes and pours it in a dirty glass. Yeah, so just, yeah. Of course, the other thing is also hygiene has been a big part of my brewer's life. And then also understanding the chemistry. So when you see what's happening in the glass, you actually know what is actually taking part there. One of the big guys that has done a lot of work around understanding foam is Professor Charlie Bamford. And some of the slides, I've actually stolen some info from him just to show you actually how much work goes into understanding foam on what's going on. Actually, the main reason is I'm really a germaphobe, and it really freaks me out.
Donnie, don't give me a dirty glass.
So really, guys, when you look at a beer and it's got a beautiful foam head on it, or, you know, for brewers, you know, once you've taken a few sips and you can actually see each sip that you've taken, there's such beauty.
Donnie, my own daughter.
Amazing! What's the juice?
The big thing is we drink with our eyes. So when you see a beer, be it, it's around the clarity, you know, you're expecting a certain thing. If it's an IPA, you expect the slight haziness in it, but the foam here, the color, we're actually drinking with our eyes. So when you get this beer and it looks like fucking dog's bollocks, it really makes me angry. So, and an important part around foam is actually what it does, right? Foam has actually got a very important part to play because it actually controls the aroma evolution out of a beer. You know, so the foam gives constant feed out. So when you bring it up to your nose, you actually get this constant feed of aroma. It doesn't just all dissipate, all the volatiles coming off, right? Foam is tactile to the lips. It's also, if you have a moustache, it reminds you that it's time for a trim. Yeah. Especially when you've got a nice white one.
Yeah.
So yeah, and then foam is also a place for it on the mouthfeel. So I think if you look at a foam, or a good foam, some of the things that you could say it's around how stable it is, the quantity, the amount. Obviously, if you're pouring it like a mugu, then you'll have a lot of foam. The lacing, I think, is very important on a beer. And then also the bubble size plays a very important part. Now, there's actually some very important things that go into beer that the brewer has done his utmost to try and get those components in. The maltster has played a role here, the farmer that grew the malt. And it's around proteins, especially ones smaller than 5 kilodaltons. The protein Z, LTP1, and Gordon. So guys actually choose malt varieties when they actually go through a program, looking at those kind of things to make sure there's enough protein. So when we brew a beer, the foam potential is there. So we've done all this work and then you put it in a dirty glass. So yes, when you do 100% malt beers, for sure, you're going to get a nice foam capacity from that. If you start putting in other adjuncts, you dilute that out and then typically your foam does get a little less. So, but the four main things that you actually get into the foam is around proteins, right, in the foam bubble, isoalpha acids. So obviously the more isoalpha acids you get, the more stable it gets. And then metal cations, divalent metal cations like magnesium and calcium, cobalt, those kind of things. They found that cobalt gives awesome foams, all right? This poisonous humans. But it also gives a nice light blue foam thing that's stable for foam. So the guys have done a lot of work around trying to understand what actually. So the metal ions actually cross-link with the isoalpha acids, making them very stable. And then there's stuff, certain polyphenols, and then non-starch polysaccharides. So if you start using stuff like oats in the starts and everything, they actually help.
Yep.
Those beta-glucans and the Robbers Islands actually help to stabilize that foam bubble and give you a nice, dense foam head that comes onto your beer. So, there's 5 things around foam that you need to understand. Right, and then you will understand what happens in a dirty glass. Right? And those 5 things that's important is how much the bubble formation and the size, so the initial pour, what comes from that, drainage of liquid in the bubble, all right, creaming or beading, and it's essentially that is replacement of the foam the whole time, and I'll talk about that. Coalescence. And then this proportionation, right? So those are the 5 terms that go around in VFO. And once you understand this, then you'll know what's actually happening in your glass. So let's quickly have a look. So this is so serious, there's actually equations. About this kind of stuff.
Some people.
So bubble formation. So obviously beer is super saturated with CO2. You might even have something of nitrogen in it. And it really then depends on how you pour it, how much foam you're going to generate. Right? So this is about the generation of the foam. If there is particulates or fiber in the glass, or there's a scratch in the glass, or even glass etching. Those are all designed to kind of produce a CO2 bubble, which then as it gets to the surface, actually forms a foam bubble that gets in there. Glass etching. You think, that's just mark the bottom of glass and there it goes. There's actually a design around that, around the radius of how big that bubble must be, that will determine how big the bubble size will be, the CO2 bubble size that comes off it, and how well it then produces the foam on that. So that's not just go in there and just do like a stamp or something in the bottom of the glass. There's actually specific size definitions that they use. Right, so and then obviously nitrogen, you guys always see nitrogen gives a nice, very, very fine bubble. And that's got to do with the lower partial pressure. And also with, when you talk about this portion, this proportionation. Hello. I'll just talk about that a little bit.
So this is bubble formation and size.
Alright, so there's the equation. So if they know what the mark is in the bottom of the glass, and then you can actually have a look at the radius of the nucleation site, so at what angle that point in the bottom of the glass is etched, you can then calculate how big that bubble will be and how much that will come off, and then to replenish the foam. So if you're looking at especially commercial glass,
so how do you actually engineer that into glass?
With laser technology. Sorry, laser.
Good Lord.
Laser beams.
Yeah. Laser beams. Guys, beer is serious stuff. Even these lasers. So, if you look at commercial beers, one of the big things is they use a lot of adjuncts. So, the protein levels and that is lower, so their foam drops away. So, what they do then is they do the nucleation points here. You have a nice natural stream of CO2 coming up, and you then constantly, as that bubble gets to the top of the surface, it encapsulates that CO2. And then you actually replenish that little that foam layer that gets in there. And that's how then the beer has got a nice constant layer of foam on it. Most of our craft breweries, we do a lot lower carbonation, so we're prone to actually not get that effect. But we have got a lot more protein in our process. So if you pour it nicely in the beginning, it should last for quite a
while. How is it proportional to the actual volume of CO2?
So the more CO2 you have, the more the faster this bead rate will be, and then the faster it will then replenish that foam that happens on there.
That groove is proportional to like if you get a laser glass, that glass is then it's for a specific volume of carbonation. Am I correct in that?
I'm not sure about that. I know what is important is the actual size of the bubble. So they'll try and make it as small as possible because you want the CO2, even though it's bleeding off, you don't want the whole thing to be like a Mentos in a Coke, you're instantly flat. You want that slow bead off that happens and you get this.
Yeah,
that
marks the stroking.
Yeah.
So, Don, is there a similar reason why a lot of beer brands across the world now are sort of creating their own glassware that they feed into pubs and places for them to use for their own brands, or
So the Belgian breweries, all those Belgian glasses, insist on their beer being poured out of their own glassware partly because of the etching and the shape for the aroma. Yeah.
Okay. I think it's also brand and all that stuff, but it's definitely part of art. Anthony?
Yeah, so my question is there a specific rate at which the bubbles form, and in terms of how long will it take for the carbonation to become, will the beer to become flat? Is that
that I don't know.
Oh, you've stumped Donnie.
Yeah. You know that it does get flat over time.
It does get flat over time, but is there a point at which it goes, okay, I've got there's no more CO2 in solution to form a bubble?
So it will definitely be dependent on temperature and pressure. So because at a specific temperature and pressure, you can maintain a certain amount of CO2. So if you're at atmospheric pressure and at a specific temperature, and you achieve the equilibrium rate of the CO2, I don't think you're going to really get much CO2 coming off from that. So if you go to...
There should still be a smidgen left.
Yeah, so you always get down, I mean, if you look at 4-5 degrees Celsius, I mean, the level of CO2 on that is typically about 1.2 volumes, even at atmospheric pressure. So you'll probably get to that level and not really go further. I mean, you've seen the next morning after a big party.
He teaspoon and he stirred my beer.
Yeah, but then you're actually putting an agitation force there.
So I'm going to shout at him.
Yeah,
you shouldn't have. If your beer gets
that, you're not really your mate.
Okay, so this is around bubble size and then how to calculate it. Right. So once you've actually formed the foam, right, there's two things that happen. So initially when you form the foam, it's actually quite wet. Right? And then a lot of the liquid in between the foam bubbles actually drains away and you get actually the dry foam. So the rate at what you get water drainage from the foam, and until it is dry, it will then collapse. And the guys can actually calculate that as well. And the biggest thing that really slows drainage, so if you're forming the foam, so if you ever pour draft in and you look at it immediately after it's finished, you'll actually see the flow of liquid in between the bubbles until it settles. And really the stuff that affects that is cold, the viscosity of the beer, the colder it is, the slower that drainage happens. And then the surface viscosity, so around alcohol and that'll affect it. And yes, there is a calculation for that as well. So I can actually calculate. So when you initially pour it, the bubbles are actually round, and then they become more hexagonal, really, as it actually dries. So all of these are really now around forming the foam and about stability of the foam. Creaming and bleeding, and this is around nucleation activity and the surface tension, and this is around when you've got the nucleation and it happens at the bottom of the glass. This is around accepting that bubble into the foam head. And that's what this is called, creaming and beading. And the stuff that affects that again is the nucleation activity. So how much etching is the bottom of the glass, all right? So how much comes up? And then the surface tension at the surface itself, then the beer density, right? So typically if it is a melting quarter or something like that, you'll get more stable foam bubbles forming. And then obviously CO2 content. The more CO2, the more feeding you can get coming from it. And again, there's a calculation around that. So you can actually model, you know, how much foam replenishment can actually happen. And I think this is answers your question from earlier. Caleb, who asked the question that I couldn't answer?
There you go.
There's
the equation. If you want to calculate it, I've
never
done it. So, enjoy. So now you've seen this. Actually, a lot of stuff that actually is happening with beer foam around a beer foam. The most important one is this one for dirty beer glasses. And that's about coalescence. Right? And coalescence is the rupturing of the bubble film between two bubbles and becoming one big bubble, right? And that weakens the whole foam character, and then it collapses quite quickly. So in a perfect beer, you get very little coalescence actually happening. So if it's a clean glass, that's why the foam stays so nice and everything. But as soon as the glass is dirty, and that's around, you know, oily snacks, and you know, if you use the same glass again and you're pouring it, you've eaten stuff, or you've got lipstick on, or all those kind of things, you know, you actually result in this coalescence. And it's one of the things that...
So basically makes beer flat faster.
Yeah. Because essentially then the beading can't get in fast enough, and it actually gets through. I mean, you've all had that beer where you looked at it and went like, yeah, sus. What?
You more than us.
You more than us, yeah.
Moscow lessons is such, you know, such chaos. There's no calculation to calculate it. You can barely see it. Right? It's either...
There's no calculation. No, it's binary. It's binary. Right?
This is visual stuff around that you can actually watch it. So coalescence. So whenever you're looking, next time you're looking at this beer that comes to you and you see this collapsing...
Train wreck.
Alright, so you can see how the bubbles stick around there. Look at the coalescence as the bubbles actually get bigger in between. And look at the collapsing points in the glass around that. And it's really around two things that's happening there, right? So coalescence is accelerated by either what they call a spreading particle or a hydrophobic particle. Right? So if the glasses are wiped on the inside and those kind of things, it can lead to actually breaking the foam bubble, or you get the hydrophobic particle that becomes part of the foam and it pushes it across open, and then you get the collapse of the beer. Right. So this is not really related to dirty glasses, and this is really only disproportionation, and that's basically over time you get bubble fusion, where the gas actually gets through the two membranes between the two bubbles, and then all eventually actually merge. And you'll find that specifically in nitrogen beers, because the bubbles are so small, you don't really get carry through, and you don't get this fusion of bubbles. And that's why nitrogenated beers are so much more stable on the ground. Alright, and you can even calculate that as well. So, and this is done by serious scientists. This mass is just... So, all of these things, you can go and measure. Right, as a brewery owner. Now, most craft breweries, we don't worry about this kind of stuff. But from my corporate days, when even Danie will know, everyone knew NIBM foam measurement, and if you were 20 seconds below the standard average, yes, there was big investigations and everything. And essentially, what this machine does, I don't know who has seen a NIBM foam instrument, it actually foams beer under a controlled, with a controlled nozzle under a specific temperature and with a specific pressure. And then it's got an electrode that floats on top of the foam and it measures the collapse time. And then you can convert that into seconds. So essentially there's it had its own room that you control at 20 degrees Celsius. You put in the sphere through the crown. It then has got a foaming device that goes into the foaming cabinet, and it brings out the beer and turns it all into foam, and then it measures the collapse of that.
So having a dirty glass then, of course, man.
Yes, dirty glasses. So there's actually a procedure, a glass washing procedure, because it's got a standardized glass a certain smoothness on the inside.
Coefficient. It's a coefficient.
So again, just getting back to the 20 years of indoctrination around how important foam is. You know, this used to be like every week, every month,
every day.
Do a report. You know it better.
Donnie, can I comment? The breweries they would compete with this.
Yeah.
So like if Donnie was at that brewery and a few was at that brewery, it's like which brewery's got the best foam stability?
Oh gosh.
There's KPIs. Because they tweak the process to get the best foam stability.
Yeah.
Did you buy our parents' bottles in the bottle store and test their parents with us?
Yeah, we used to check other people's stuff. We used to cross-check other breweries when they claim very good foams and stuff. So when they get like an extraordinary one, we're like, no, send us a case, we want to check this out.
Send us your recipe.
So we used to have foam seminars. And I actually found one while I was going through all my notes. I actually found a foam sharing from the Elro Brewery. And it was literally like 30 pages of analysis from across the world. Because at that stage, it used to be Miller. So it was about, I don't know, what's it, 200 breweries or something like that. And you look at the 25% worst percentile and the 25% best percentile. And all those breweries are ranked. And you can see their rating, and it's compared against adjunct ratio and gravity and alcohol, less than 4.5, more than 4.5. So yeah.
How much money?
So if you're gonna sell me a beer and I'm gonna pay $45 for it, you know, just take the effort and put it in a clean glass.
Okay, Donnie, just a question: Would you take it if it was cheaper?
So this is what I do when I get into a restaurant. The first thing I do, right? So normally my daughter is there and wife. They get a cool drink, whatever. I smell the glass before they put the cool drink in. So I actually smell it. If it smells like freaking
vegetables,
just give me a bottle. I'll drink from the bottle. Already. So, because if they can't even wash a cool drink glass clean that hasn't had anything in it. The other thing I do is I look around. I look at what's coming out of the bar area. And I watch the waiters come past and like, yeah, okay. That's almost all the glasses are clean, or yes, this one is bad, this one is not, you know. And then I also make a decision to grow a drink out of a bottle. I have been asked to leave the restaurant before. Cantonians don't like it when you this is a long street.
Maybe this is about when Bronwyn should come in and tell us what she thinks about this.
Exactly. She gets annoyed with me.
Donnie, my other favorite is if the pub takes the glass out of a fridge.
Freezer.
I don't want a freezer. The fridge is stick.
Yeah, but it's generally. The reason why a lot of that happens is because they turn the window glasses wash, they turn it upside down, and then the drinking surface actually is on the metal on the metal surface or whatever. So if you're washing the glass and it's properly clean, it should be upside down on a drip drying rack, plastic or lines or something like that. So I've seen that a lot as well. When they've got to pry it loose from the fridge, because the whole fridge thing has been wiped for so long.
Donnie, from his is there's ice crystals now on your glass, right?
Yeah.
So what's going to happen? It looks like a dirty glass, doesn't it?
That's exactly what happens.
Nuclearization.
So if you go to Capital Craft in Pretoria, so one day I was sitting there and eventually it came down to, you know, it would leave some mark, you know, some marks and places, and it was because of the glass is coming out the fridge. So if it doesn't come out the fridge, it was pouring perfectly. I was asked to leave the restaurant after I showed them that you just use proper washing technique, and I made them pour one in their glass and one in my clean wash glass, and it was day and night difference. And then the owner was quite upset, and the thing is, if the glass is not clean, so the question is, can you use the glass rinse? Yes, but the glass must be washed, must be clean. If I've been drinking out of this glass, I'm quite happy for them to rinse it and serve it again in that glass, because I've drunk from it, so if there's something in there, I know it's me. That's fine. Then I'm not too worried about it.
So it's about you being a germaphobe.
Yep. Yeah, yeah, basically, I said it on the first slide. Yeah.
It's not all that stuff is just the nonsense. Only going to affect the carbonation, possibly. That's yes, the only
thing. To affect the carbonation, and also the other thing is, what is it? What is in there? Why do you want to pay $45 for a beer and it looks the way it does?
Sorry, guys, if it's a dirty glass, chances are it's got an aroma component that's shit as well.
Yeah.
And you're going to then pour a clean beer into a glass that smells of vegetables. And then wonder why the beer is a shit.
I mean, where is the level that it gets returned? I mean, a slight streak of bubbles.
I apply some common sense. If it's one little line, if I can take the glass and I do this, and it's gone, then I say, okay, that's fine. But okay. If I do that, and I've got it. So you made an African brew like it.
I've had experiences with a glass washer with the chemicals and stuff. Those machines, sometimes their dosing acts up, and they've got the cleaning solution.
The rinse, to dry out.
God knows if you don't spritz those glasses, you'd still get a lacing of that, and it's done for your beers.
But you'll also get the rinse aid actually also nullifies the foam. So,
Danie, I wanted to get into that. So, what is the chemical action or chemical process of a rinse aid? What is rinse aid? And then how does that interact with foam?
So, it's around the bubble membrane, and it actually just creates the coalescence. It destabilizes.
So is it, it must be a surfactant.
Yeah, it's basically surfactant.
So if a dishwasher or whatever is not rinsing out properly after the application of that rinse aid, that's part of the reason.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got an Irish friend of mine who will not drink beer out of a glass that hasn't been rinsed with just ordinary tap water. Because he says that the rinse aid always messes up with the foam.
Yeah. So I personally prefer to go just a quick rinse myself as well. So guys, it's so easy with the boy or the Czech knockoff one. It's got a brush in there, it takes everything off.
Do you have a picture of that? What are you talking about?
Full boy.
Schoolboy.
So the one, it's like a toilet brush.
Squid
ink.
Yeah, but not the toilet brush. But you can
buy a real toilet brush.
That's waste paper. No, not waste paper. At Galmar, they sell a thing that you can stick on your sink that looks like a toilet brush, and then it washes the glass the same as a pool.
So these are very expensive. I guess they probably.
Is this for your home consumption?
This is the cheap knockoff one. About $3,000, $3,500, I think.
And the one on the right,
$30.
Yeah. So that is that.
That's what I'm saying. So we can put a big bar.
Three or four washes and turns in the washing section, and then this speed is actually push it down. It actually activates the sprays and it rinses everything out. Glass done. You can serve it.
Because the water is recycled with the brand.
This water basically stays in there, but every time you use it, a little bit fresh water gets put in. It drains into the sink. The rinse is every time it's new.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Cool.
It's all cold.
Thanks, Danie. Yeah. And I said, but all's cool with you, Pastor.
Thanks, Danie. Sorry, Chessie. Check the meter. Okay, thanks, Danie.